Hello, welcome to my channel. Today, in the second part of Vachak Katta or the Reader's Corner, I am going to talk about a book. Some of my friends and well-wishers suggested that I should do this series in English so that it will reach to multiple people. Henceforth, Vachak Katta or the Reader's Corner will be in English. Who doesn't like the gossip? Who doesn't like to know about the scandals? And when it belongs to your own industry, you just want to grab it and read it throughout the single sitting. So, let me tell you a bit about myself. I work in pharmaceutical industry. To be specific, generic pharma industry in India. I'm proud to be a part of one of the most trusted and ethical generic company. And today, I am telling you about a book that talked about the biggest scandal of Indian pharma industry. The book is Bottle of Lies, The Inside Story of the Generic Drug Boom by Catherine Eban. It unleashes the insider information of the famous Ranbaxy scandal. Catherine has definitely taken an immense effort wherein she interviewed about 240 people directly or indirectly involved in this fraud. This also includes the on-ground reporting from India, China, Ghana, England, Ireland, Mexico, and of course, the USA. Before moving on to the book, I'll give a little idea about how the generic pharma industry in USA works. The Drug Price Competition and Patent Term Restoration Act, or the famous Hatch-Waxman Act, was enacted in US to encourage the manufacture of generic drugs. The act was sponsored by Representative Henry Waxman of California and Senator Orrin Hatch of Utah State. Prior to this act, before submitting any application, the generic company had to perform in vivo or clinical study on humans to prove the safety and efficacy of their formulations. After this act, the generics need not perform any in vivo studies. Rather, they had to perform certain in vitro studies which can be performed in lab to show that their products are bioequivalent to the innovator product. It means that their products are safe, effective, and have similar release profile as that of innovator product. This application is called Abbreviated New Drug Application, or ANDA. The bioequivalence guidance published and recommended by FDA states a statistical analysis for pharmacokinetic measure, including area under the curve and Cmax. It proposes a calculation of 90% confidence interval for the ratio of averages and a requirement that this confidence interval fall within a range of 80 to 120% bioequivalence. Now, let us move on to the book. Ranbaxy came into limelight when they filed an application for Lipitor, the famous drug atorvastatin. The person, the whistleblower, the most courageous man in this case is Mr. Dinesh Thakur, who first intimated FDA about the scandal by sending an anonymous email under the name M. I must say, after each page I was reading this book, I realized Dinesh has put himself in grave danger. Not just him, but life of his wife, Sonal Thakur, and two children were jeopardized by his act. India still is nothing less than Gotham City, and when he worked on this, the part of India where he and his family were living was the most dangerous part. A person could vanish from there anytime, and if you want to find out about it, then you have to start at the bottom of the sea. To prove the bioequivalence of their products to the innovator product, Ranbaxy has gone to such an extent that all data was manipulated. The backdating of documents was done. Fake data of the tests, which were never performed, was created by the analyst. The innovator drug samples were imported, powdered, and mixed in their sample to show FDA that their product was equivalent. The product degradation data was manipulated. For example, if the product had a shelf life of only 9 months, then it was shown to be stable for 12 months. With each page that I read about the extent of scandal, I was shocked to the core, questioned myself about the reliability of generic drugs. I had to stop reading the book at least 3 to 4 times to absorb what I had just read. The products that were not passed in FDA audit were distributed in India and African countries under the United States President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, or also known as PEPFAR program, where, according to them, lives didn't matter much. Not just a junior level analyst or a chemist, but the top level executives, including CEO Malvinder Singh, his brother Shivinder, director Brian Tempest, head of regulatory Abha Pant, were involved in this scandal. Dr. Rashmi Barbaya and Mr. Dinesh Thakur had joined the company from Bristol Myers. When Dr. Barbaya came to know about this, he chose to live quietly with the compensation of over $1 million to keep quiet. Dinesh could have done that, but he chose to be different. He spoke about it. He informed FDA. He went through an immense physical and mental instability, which led later on to his divorce with his wife Sonal. At each point when I read about this, I thought that he could have confided to her while going through this. But he chose to go through it alone, probably with the intention to protect his family. Dinesh Thakur had prepared a PowerPoint presentation of 24 slides called Self-Assessment Report, or SAR, which covered almost all the products of Ranbaxy in regulated, semi-regulated, and unregulated markets where the products have been tampered or fake data was created. This presentation was later destroyed under the direction of Mr. Brian Tempest. In fact, even the computer in which it was created was destroyed. The major problem for this fraud was hidden for years was US FDA never checked a plant without announcement. The FDA had to provide a notice along with the dates for plant inspection, which gave Ranbaxy enough time to tamper the data, change existing data, or create the data for tests which were never performed, and later backdating the documents. By the time FDA took this scandal seriously and finally made Ranbaxy pay for it, it had already approved 17 drugs for the US market. This figure is quite high and disturbing considering market covered millions of US citizens. Further, in this book, Catherine also points out to the casual Indian attitude and the jugaad that we perform, the Chalta Hai Indian culture. She points out that this attitude is a part of Indian culture, which absolutely saddened me. At every point, it made very clear to me that we need to work really hard to change this global impression. Catherine states about the deep down corruption at the US FDA, which is considered to be one of the most stringent regulatory bodies in the world. If the level of corruption is as much in the US FDA, then let us better not talk about other drug regulatory agencies. The only point in the book that I did not agree with was Catherine puts all the Indian and foreign generic, including Mylan and Teva, in line with Ranbaxy, something that is not acceptable. We have come a long way from the Ranbaxy scandal to establishing ourselves as one of the most trusted industries with the recent license to develop Remdesivir for recent COVID-19 and Favipiravir, which is presently under clinical trials. In addition, Author also suggests manipulation of bioequivalence data by all the major pharma companies. If the drug is not acting on a patient, it means that the data is manipulated, which is not true. Most of the generic companies perform a diligent pharmacovigilance of their marketed products, wherein doctors and patient complaints are taken seriously. Apart from this, every patient's body reacts to a drug in a different way. The drugs that are deemed to be bioequivalent may act totally differently from one patient to another. Ranbaxy later paid $500 million to US FDA to settle the case. The company does not exist anymore. Generic pharma giant Sun Pharma later bought it from Daiichi and is now a Sun Pharma subsidiary. The only question that bothers the author as a person and as a vigilant citizen is that all the Ranbaxy executives, right from the bottom to top, who are working in other companies. They have been so habitual for creating manipulated data as well as hiding it successfully from US FDA that there is no guarantee that they are following the good manufacturing practices and creating untampered data. The thought is scary when you realize that they are playing with the life of billions of people in the world. In the end, as far as the book is concerned, it may be a little bit boring and a drag for people who do not understand industrial jargon. Because I am a pharmaceutical professional, it was easy to understand fast as I was familiar with most of the concepts. I suggest if you are really interested to know about how pharma industry works, then this book is for you. Apart from the scandal itself, Catherine explains the entire regulatory process and the industry jargon in simple words. I hope you have liked this video. If you have liked it, then please share, comment, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.